The corset changed the bodies of those that wore them, but not in the way you think. Many throughout history, and especially in the 21st century, have argued that the corset is a physically damaging symbol of historical female oppression, and today I want to talk about that. Arguably one of the most controversial items of clothing to have ever come out of fashion history, it has been discussed at length by scholars, academics, people on social media, and it's especially apparent in pop culture, from Keira Knightley as Elizabeth Swann in Pirates of the Caribbean, to everyone's favorite Regency fashion film Netflix drama series Bridgerton, and it has even seen a recent comeback in current fashion trends such as cottagecore. Hello everybody, welcome to or welcome back to my channel. If you are new here, my name is Katie, otherwise known as the Vintage Academic. I am a transfer student at UC Berkeley, I'm a senior, and I study anthropology and archaeology. Now, something that you might not know about me, aside from the fact that my online handle is the Vintage Academic, is that I have been interested in fashion history essentially my entire life. And seeing as somebody who is currently a student in anthropology, I have been wanting to understand fashion history and specifically the corset, not just through the fashion historical perspectives that are often shared on YouTube in the costuming community, but from an anthropological, archaeological perspective. As any sane person would do, I decided to kill two birds with one stone, and while I investigate the corset and share my research with you, the audience, I am also producing this video that I am actually sharing on my YouTube channel, which is kind of terrifying to me, as part of my submission of a larger project that I'm working on at UC Berkeley for my paleopathology class. So since this is a research assignment for school, this video might be a little bit dense, a little bit long, so please bear with me, grab a snack, a cup of tea, and settle in. Now, if you've explored any part of the historical costuming community on social media, you've probably come across people like Isabella Pryor Attire or Bernadette Banner, just to name a few, who both share amazing information about historical fashion. While Isabella Pryor Attire focuses more on the anecdotal side of things and sharing what it's actually like to wear a corset and historically accurate clothing in the 21st century, the amazing Bernadette Banner aims her informative videos more towards the historical research side of things. But what is common between the two of them is that whether it's anecdotal or historical evidence, they both talk a lot about busting common corset myths. And since busting corset myths is all about addressing the way that history has developed a misogynistic narrative of women, and also to help us understand topics from a complex and nuanced perspective, to contribute to this conversation, I want to talk about the bioarchaeological perspective of the corset. But first, since my content doesn't really center around fashion history, let's take it back a step and just ask, what is the corset? The corset, to put it very shortly, is a supportive undergarment that is worn in order to create a certain silhouette by changing the shape of the waist, hips, and bust. The corset, being a piece of material culture, also carries with it a lot of cultural meaning. Whether it's its style, construction, the materials used, it indicates things like social status of the person wearing it, as well as just societal norms in general from that time period. So now that that is out of the way, like I said, it was very brief, let's focus on the actual point of this video, which is understanding why it's important to also take a bioarchaeological perspective. To put it briefly, bioarchaeology sometimes uses a framework called the biocultural approach, which focuses on exploring the interactive relationship between human biology and culture. This is important to understand for the sake of this video because the corset, which is a piece of material culture, did indeed interact with the biology of the people that wore them and changed the bodies of those that wore them. But just not quite in the way you think it did. By taking this perspective, we can look at an inherently cultural practice as it relates to the body and the archaeological record. So historically, anthropological corset research has argued that fashion trends like corsetry are a form of, quote, chronic violence perpetrated against women revealed in skeletal deformation. But the thing is, when you actually go and read these articles, these types of arguments aren't backed up by any actual evidence from the archaeological record, with some researchers themselves even saying that there is, quote, little data to assess the impact of corsetry in the archaeological record. So even if this is true, that there's no data in the archaeological record to indicate the impact of corsetry, even without this incredibly important data, they still make these claims not backed up by any evidence, remember, that the act of wearing a corset caused direct consequences to your health, like, quote, internal organ displacement, shortness of breath, obstructed bowels, incontinence, and prolapsed uterus. which, by the way, all comes from a citation from 1903, nearly 120 years ago. And this might be a little bit of a tangent, but this time frame is really important to keep in mind because, as it's argued in the main star of the show that we'll talk about later, The Corseted Skeleton by Rebecca Gibson, medical school curriculums were not standardized until a year later in 1904, meaning that medical and especially anatomical knowledge of medical professionals that recorded instances of things like bisected livers and displaced organs lacked a standardized medical education and, quite frankly, probably lacked any anatomical knowledge at all, since becoming a doctor in the 19th century wasn't as standardized as it is today, and most often that information, that knowledge, was passed down from doctor to apprentice rather than learning it through a standardized medical school curriculum. However, recent trends in bioarchaeological research that actually uses data from the archaeological record have revealed that a bioarchaeological approach that takes into account other factors at play in somebody's health, such as nutrition, socioeconomic status, a number of babies a person has given birth to, what people wore, their environment, all of the things that we anthropologists call culturally mediated factors, can actually address and bust common corset myths. If I could give you an example of how bioarchaeological data is really important to understanding corset myths, let's take a look at the famous myth that people who corseted did not live as long as people who didn't. While it may be true that the average life expectancy of a woman in the 1700 to 1900s, which is around the height of corset wearing, was about 35 years of age, that number is actually a misconstrued statistic. That number comes from the fact that female children died frequently from things like disease and accidents before reaching their 18th birthday, which in turn lowers the average life expectancy of people. In actuality, the average lifespan of a woman who had reached adulthood in Rebecca Gibson's sample was around 50 years of age, with the oldest woman in that skeletal sample living well past 80. And I need everybody who's watching this to know that I actually did that math myself. I added up all of the ages of the individuals in her sample and did that math myself, so I'm proud of myself. So this means that corseted women did actually live longer than popular thought would have you believe. And Gibson also goes on to talk about the fact that things like socioeconomic status had a larger impact on the longevity of your life, more than whether or not that specific skeleton had markers of wearing a corset. In other words, being poor was a more important factor into how long you lived, not your corset. But let's take it a step further and see what the bones actually have to say about this topic. Now, real quick, let me reel it back for a second so we can do a quick lesson on bones. Just some background information that you need to understand what I'm gonna say next. So our bones remodel once every 10 years as adults. So this means that we have a system inside of our body where we have osteoblasts and osteoclasts, which are these little guys that go around and munch up old bone and put down new bone. This means that our bones are actually pretty plastic and responsive to our environment, and they're not just lumps of calcified stone sitting inside our bodies. They can actually change shape depending on what you do. So, regardless of what you do, if you do it long enough, it can actually change the way your bones look. As anyone who has tried on a corset might know, corsets do in fact put some pressure on your abdomen, on your rib cage, on your waistline, you know, the part of the body that the corset goes on. This means that if you wear them long enough and put enough pressure on your body, it can change the way your bones look. In the sample that I keep talking about, examined by Rebecca Gibson in the book The Corseted Skeleton, she compares an average 21st century ribcage to a collection of skeletons from the St. Bride's Parish Lower Churchyard in London. She found that a non-corseted body averaged ribcage dimensions that were about a ratio of 1 to 47, which, to simplify things, means that an average ribcage should look like an oval. The ribcage dimensions of the skeletons in Gibson's samples, however, had more of a 1 to 1 ratio, meaning that they looked like a circle. This means that the corsets that women were wearing in the time period of the skeletons that Rebecca Gibson was looking at was putting enough pressure on the ribcage to actually shift the angle of the ribs where they meet the vertebra or the spine, and also rounded the ribs into more of a C shape. Another factor that she talks about in this study is the changes to the spinous process of the vertebra, which is actually the part of your back that you can feel if you run your finger down your spine. An average spinous process should average about a 45 degree angle, but those in the skeletal sample averaged between 10 and 30 degrees, meaning that, again, the corset was putting enough pressure on the spine to actually change the shape of the vertebra that make up the spinal column. But what is, in my opinion, perhaps the most important part of Gibson's argument in her book isn't the fact that the corsets did actually cause biological changes in the body, but the way that Gibson argues that this wasn't a single traumatic, damaging, and oppressive event like people have written about in the past. Think bisected livers and removed ribs and things like that. It was simply a part of everyday life that didn't didn't really give you much cause to think about it more than you would think about our underwear here in the 21st century. Bone remodeling takes time. It took time for the corset to impress these changes on the bodies of those people that were wearing them. It's not just a sudden and violent change, it was simply a part of everyday life. And this is really the message that this study is trying to convey, and it also contributes to the voices of other people who write about this topic, such as Valerie Steele in A Corset, The Cultural History, where she talks about the corset not being a tool of oppression, but rather that we should understand it as a nuanced and varied experience. Now, Rebecca Gibson isn't the only person to have actually taken a look to try and understand the actual impacts of wearing a corset in the archaeological record and not just taking things from a negative perspective, which is something that's almost never talked about in scholarship about corsetry, which is a shame because it really shows how a deeply cultural, nuanced item can serve different purposes to different people in different time periods. The first one that comes to mind is a skeleton that showed evidence of that person having worn a corset in their lifetime as an orthopedic therapeutic treatment for something called Pott's disease, which is a progression of the disease tuberculosis that can cause degeneration of the spine. The other study that I came across while researching this topic is that of a medieval high-status burial, where the researchers speculate that a corset-like garment was worn in order to treat a chest deformity called pectus carinatum. I apologize for my pronunciation in that, I never learned Latin. And as we know again from the wonderful Bernadette Banner and also just 21st century medicine, corset-like devices called braces, hard plastic shells, are used to treat modern diseases of the spine like scoliosis. Speaking of the 21st century, while it is not strictly archaeological, there have also been some attempts to understand what the physiological impact might have been on the people who wore corsets on the regular. And the reason why I bring this up is because data like this is important to understanding what the lived experiences was of people who actually wore corsets, which is something that we talk about in the biocultural perspective, and also in something called an osteobiography, which attempts to understand the lived experience, the life of an individual through their archaeological evidence. So the study that I'm thinking of looked at historical reenactors who wore corsets during their reenactment duties, and noted that those who tight-laced reported shortness of breath that was easily relieved with rest, and that otherwise there were no serious physiological effects that they could see on the body from wearing a corset. What I think is important to note, besides the fact that there were no lasting impacts on these reenactors, is that they were able to attend to all of their daily duties without serious limitations. So, now that I've talked ad nauseum about the research, something that I need to address in this video is to talk about what kind of impact I'm hoping to make by producing this video as part of my assignment. So, let me take a little detour away from the research and talk about the purpose of me making this video for a minute. Misogyny is really what fuels and sits at the heart of most corset myths. And it's not only important to address this in academic studies using an evidence-based argument and not making grand claims that aren't backed up by evidence, like I said earlier in this video, but it's also important to me to share this kind of information with a wider audience in a form that is more palatable than the dense and dry form that most academic articles take. Not to mention, most academic articles are behind a paywall. In addition, when it comes to the corset, I think that people, whether they be scholar or movie producer, place far too much emphasis on tight lacing, which is where corsets are tightened to some ambiguous extreme in order to achieve cosmetic modifications, which was, by and far, the exception and not the norm. The thing is, corseting and tight lacing are not synonymous. Much like extreme body modifications that we can see in our 21st century world, such as the Kardashian sisters or episodes of My Strange Addiction that focus on things like plastic surgery, these spotlighted experiences of extreme body modification are not the norm and are very different from what would statistically be considered average. And by focusing so heavily on tight lacing and the possible physiological impacts that it had that aren't backed up by evidence and data, it narrows down the experience of women throughout history to that of trivial, vain, or frivolous pursuits. Much like Joan Entwistle in her book, The Fashioned Body, which I would very much recommend reading, and Valerie Steele in The Corset, A Cultural History, argue, they quote, insist on the need to distinguish between ordinary fashionable corsetry as practiced by most 19th century women and the minority fetishistic practice of tight lacing. Most corset wearing stayed within the realms of ordinary fashion, with only a minority of corset producers reporting greater demands for smaller and smaller corsets. This is even backed up by Bernadette Banner in her video, I Grew Up in a Corset, Time to Bust Some Myths, where she talks about seamstresses' measurements for creating corsets not varying all that much from modern contemporary sizes. Focusing so much on tight lacing also doesn't take into account the fact that people had other tools in order to create the illusion of a small waist, but a biocultural approach might understand that people used things like hip pads and bust pads and crinolines and skirt cages in order to create the illusion that people actually had a smaller waist when they didn't. Now, like I said, all of this matters because myths about corsetry that continue to be perpetuated throughout history build a misogynistic narrative of women. These myths typically revolve around things like women not living as long, women not being able to work because of their corset, or that the corset was inherently sexual. All ideas that contribute to an image of the historical woman that reduces them down to a single garment of clothing. But by turning to new data that's being gathered from a variety of fields and perspectives, such as the biocultural approach or the feminist approach, we can do better to support a narrative that proves that, quote, women were and are strong, long-lived, and agentive. Now, I believe I have just about come to the end of what I wanted to say about this topic. Of course, this is an incredibly complicated and nuanced subject with a lot of scholarship behind it, and I definitely had a hard time taking all of this information and paring it down into something that would fit into a YouTube video. So I'd highly recommend anybody who is still watching to go ahead and check my description, because I'm going to be leaving citations to all of the references that I used in order to create this video. They all include different perspectives and different ways of approaching and thinking about the corset, so I really recommend taking them a look if you want to learn more. I just really want you watching this video to come away from this video with a better understanding that wearing a corset wasn't an inherently negative thing, that it served a lot of purposes, and that the way that people wore corsets was just as varied as the way that you and I wear our clothes today. Lastly, something I would absolutely love to do is I would really like to take the analytical data from this YouTube video and put it into a report to submit along with this video as part of my assignment. So if you've made it this far, it would mean a lot to me if you engaged in this video in some way. Give it a like, definitely drop me a comment, let me know, have your views on the corset changed, and if so, how? As always, don't forget to subscribe for my channel for more anthropology-related content. This was really my first time developing a video like this and sharing it on my YouTube channel, and I would love to do more in the future if you would love to see more in the future, so definitely let me know. Thank you so much for watching, and now I would like to leave you with this quote from Rebecca Gibson's book. The corset was changing their bodies, but not necessarily their lives. See you in the next one.